We are wrapping up a series called Love Actually, where we've been exploring two different paradigms about love and relationships and marriage. And I want to quickly kind of recap you through the last 5 weeks. If you're just joining us today, this is kind of like the epilogue of a great book. But if you like some of the things I share with you over the next few minutes, you can listen to all of this on our podcast. If you go to newlifepetaluma.org, you can listen on the website. We've got a New Life Petaluma podcast. You can pull it up on your smart device and listen to it that way as well. So just want you to know it's all out there. And while I'm recapping you, you might want to grab your teaching notes because they've got the Bible verses we're looking at and some fill in the blanks and some next steps. You're definitely going to want to grab this Start Here card because I'm going to give us some things that we can do or some resources we can get later on this morning. So grab those. I'll tell you what to do with them a little later. But the basic idea of this series is this. There are two main paradigms when it comes to love and marriage. The first is kind of the one that we all know, and we call it the contract model. The contract model goes something like this. You do your part, they do their part. We've got a contract. Usually it's unspoken, but it comes based on how we were raised, when we were raised, gender, our ethnicity, all these different pieces go to play into who does what in the contract. And in the contract model, we're both happy. If I do my part, you do your part. Respect builds. Respect turns into admiration, maybe friendship, ultimately love, and you live happily ever after. But what we said was that the contract model has some major flaws in it. The first is this: no one can keep the contract perfectly for more than about your honeymoon. And when the other person doesn't keep the contract perfectly, we get angry at them and we think, well, that gives me license to not keep my end of the contract. Another problem with this is when things get busy, life gets stressful, money gets tight, work gets hard, kids get loud, we start to get to the base common denominator of that contract. I'm going to do as little as I possible to fulfill my part of the contract. You do as little as you can. And in the end, we just become really good at being housemates. I'm doing my part. You're doing your part. That's when the kids leave for college and you look at each other and you say, I don't actually know you anymore. I don't actually feel like I love you. Whatever that term love is, we used to have it. But it's gone, gone, gone. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Ba-doom, ba. Jim liked that. It's gone. That is what happens with the contract. So we said there's a different model that God lays out for us, and it's a model that is totally unfair. I said that from the very beginning. There's no fairness in this model. Someone has to go first. Someone has to outdo the other person. And it goes something like this. I'm going to put she before me every day of my life. I'm going to put he before me every day of my life. Paul says it like this: submit or surrender yourselves one to another, or put them first in the priority train, as Ron laid out last week. So we've been talking about these two models, and then using these two models, we've been exploring things like how to build safety in a relationship, because transformation only comes when you feel safe to actually be yourself. How to communicate in a relationship that goes beyond fact sharing to life sharing and emotions and the deeper levels of communication. I thought Ron laid out brilliantly what it looks like when we get into a fight. Who's to blame? And most of us would say, well, they're to blame because before they were here, we didn't fight. But the truth is, there's something in here. And they just happen to be the only person we've allowed in far enough that whatever's in here is coming out. So Ron talked about the fact that we have an enemy of our marriages. God says that there is an enemy who's trying to steal, kill, and destroy, and he wants to rob you of happiness and joy in your marriage and fulfillment, that he's to blame, and there's something going on in here. And I thought Ron did a great job laying that out. What I want to do today is put a bow on the whole thing, because my biggest fear as a pastor and as your friend is that you come into a series like this, which, in my humble but correct opinion, has been an excellent series. Like, this has been really, no one talks about this stuff. You don't go to a PTA meeting and talk about this stuff. You don't go, you know, to a group and talk about this stuff, a book club necessarily, and talk about this. The church should be talking about this kind of stuff, and we have been, and I love that. We might not do it perfectly, but listen, we're starting conversations. But my big fear is that you're going to walk out of a sermon series like this and actually think we need to end our marriage. That it actually goes the opposite direction of what I want. And it happens because of one thing. And this one thing doesn't just happen in marriages. When we look at marriage, you can actually pick anything. So if you're not married today, you could talk about career. This is the one thing that has us giving up on our career when we're just steps away from what we could be. This is the thing that has us giving up on friendships. Listen, if you find that you have serial friendships, I have a friend, we get to a certain level of depth and intimacy, and then I need to move to the next friend. This could be the thing that's stopping it. This is the thing that has us giving up on church. I've been there, I've done that, I tried it, it didn't work, I'm gone. Ultimately, this is the thing that I watch people give up on God because of this, and it's a mindset more than an action. So today I want to talk about this mindset and talk about a different way to view life, because boy, it would break my heart if we got to the end of a series on marriage and on building intimacy and building oneness, and you left with a sense that I need out. And here's what that thing is. I call it a destination thinking. Destination thinking. And destination thinking goes something like this. Because I know the ideal destination, I should right now be at the ideal destination. We live in a microwave, immediate culture, which says, I know it, I want it, I need to have it. And usually in life, we can get it pretty quickly. You see something on Amazon, you like it, you order it, the next day it's there. Some places it's getting there that afternoon. And this mindset goes like this. We equate knowing something to being able to do something or undo something. So you might be 15 years into a contract model in your marriage. And as we were talking about this, you realized, oh my gosh, that's us. We live squarely in a contract model. We have for the last 10 years or 15 years. Or you know, we've got some unhealthy patterns, lack of communication, lack of intimacy. There's no safety in our marriage. And we've been this way for 10 years. And then you hear this series and you think to yourself, well, now that I know what I should be doing, Kevin and Ron laid out two different views, I should naturally be here. And so we walk out of a series like this and we actually feel worse about ourselves and worse about our marriage because now we know the ideal destination. And we think to ourselves that knowing the ideal destination means that we should be at the ideal destination. And it could go with anything. It could go with your relationship with God. I've been following God for, you know, let's say 5 years. I know what God says. I know what God promises. I'm not experiencing all of that right now. Maybe God just doesn't work for me. Or I've been in this church and we had the honeymoon phase. It was fun. It was funny. It was engaging. The worship was great. But then I realized, oh my gosh, this church is made up of people and these people aren't perfect. But it's the church, right? Jesus gives this great call for the church. We think, well, then I got to get out. This is destination thinking. The scariest thing about destination thinking is destination thinking has us working in this mindset. Win or loss, pass or fail. Black or white. There is no gray. There is no process. There is no journey. You could say it like this. Destination thinking has us feeling like we're failing every time we're less than perfect. I've got two kids. Maddie's in third grade. Landon's in kindergarten. Maddie takes after her mom when it comes to intelligence. She's a really, really bright kid. Maddie was doing her spelling list for third grade. She went, I think, 17 weeks or 18 weeks without ever missing one single spelling word on one spelling list. I know, that literally never happened in the Finkbeiner house. Not one time, not ever. Like, whatever the low group was, that was me. Thank you very much. So Maddie goes 17 weeks. It's like day one, we're practicing her spelling list. She's getting them all right on Monday. I'm thinking, how do you do this? Well, she came home a couple weeks ago. She had missed one word. Out of 15, now one. Now that is still squarely in the A category, winning. That would go on my fridge when I was a kid. One word, we're getting frozen yogurt. Like, very good, very good. She came home embarrassed to show us the list and feeling bad because she missed a word. Why? Because anything other than perfection, she got in this mindset. Anything other than perfection is failure, even though she got an A on the spelling list. If I could go back again, I would say to her on week 2 or week 3, misspell a word intentionally. Just get it wrong, get it over with. I think we should learn how to fail early and often, because the longer we go in perfection, the harder it is when we finally fail. Isn't that true? And it leads us to feeling like anything other than arrived is failure. Now let me ask you this question, and I want you to really think about this. How long would you fail before you gave up? It could be in your marriage, could be parenting, could be in a job that you're trying to get up, could be in trying to get a job, could be in education. How long would you, if anything less than perfection is failing, how long will you fail before you choose to give up? Because see, this is what happens in this type of a teaching series. We see the ideal, we come face to face with the real, and when the real and the ideal don't match up, we feel like we're failing. And if that weight becomes too heavy, we will choose out when God's desire is that we would choose in. It's the exact opposite. And that's because Jesus actually invites us into a different type of journey. That's what I want to talk about today, is a different journey. I want to look at Jesus calling his first followers to himself. They became his closest friends. They were his disciples. These were the people that after Jesus left and went up to heaven would start the church, would basically continue this movement that Jesus had launched and be the leaders of this church. And it says, as Jesus was going by the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and Andrew. Andrew was the brother of Simon. And they were casting their nets into the sea because they were fishermen. Jesus said to them, I want you to underline the rest of this sentence. He said, follow me, and I will make you become. I will make you become fishers of men. And immediately they left their nets and they followed him. See, Jesus understood a different type of mindset. He didn't say, come on, you seem good enough, you seem almost perfect, you're 98% there, come on over, I'm pretty sure you can get 100% in the first week, and then we're off to the races. He said, follow me. And it's so different for us, because we feel like, well, they had Jesus right there with them. But here's a cool thing, and we're going to talk about this next week. Jesus said it was better for him to leave, because we got something just as powerful as Jesus being walking with us. And we've got it every day. But just put yourself in this mindset. The disciples, they walked with Jesus. They had campfires with Jesus. They roasted fish with Jesus. They told jokes and stories, and they processed their day. They had true friendship with him. And Jesus says, as you follow me, I will, Jesus says, make you become. And that word become literally means I will bring something out of nothing. He didn't say you're almost good enough. You're at 98% and I'm just going to take you to the last 2%. He said, walk with me. Be in relationship with me. That's your job. Your job is to be in relationship with me. My job is to bring something out of nothing, not to lead you to perfection, but to lead you to transformation. These guys were fishermen, ordinary, kind of unschooled, salt of the earth fishermen, and Jesus says, I'm going to make you become, and it's a wordplay, fishers of men. Jesus basically says this, listen, I found you when you were casting your nets. I invited you into a relationship with me, and now I want you to go find other people, because we know that's true. Found people find people. Do you remember when you first became a follower of Jesus? It was just natural to talk to people about God. Hey, come check out my church. This place is great. You don't know what's going on. Hey, listen to what's happening to me. That was my story. I would sit outside. I'd smoke cigarettes in college talking about Jesus. Like anybody who's around, we're at the little smoker's corner. We just talk. It's like we were very French. Hey, let's talk about Jesus. Like we were just, that's good. That just came out second service. You're welcome, second service. Talk about Jesus. But we would. We'd sit around. We were just ordinary people. It wasn't like we had this big, like, okay, here's the plan. We're going to get our friends into a room. We're going to say, okay, let me ask you about your eternity. No, we were just talking about Jesus, because found people find people. That's what we do. I met Jesus. He's changing my life. He could change your life too. It's like one starving man telling another starving man where to find a Christmas ham. We just do. And he says, come with me. Your job is to walk with me. My job is to bring something out of nothing. I wonder how many of us right now, in some area of our life, we really need God to bring something out of nothing. And we're striving to bring something out of nothing ourselves, thinking it's our job to produce something out of nothing. And Jesus is saying, you've got it backwards. Your job is to walk with me, is to be open to me, is to be sensitive to me. My job is to bring something out of nothing. You will become. This was their mindset. It's a journey mindset. A journey mindset says this: I'm learning how to walk in partnership with God. That's my job. By the way, that's each of our job. We learn how to walk in partnership with God on a lifelong journey where God is helping us to become. He's changing and he's transforming. And our big idea today is simply this: you and I are in process. It doesn't mean you're failing. It means you're humaning. We are in process. Your marriage is in process. Your kids are in process. Your vocation is in process. Your finances are in process. It doesn't mean you're failing. Our job is to walk with God. God's job is to bring transformation. And that's not my opinion. That is actually God's word on it. I want to go to Paul. I'm gonna use this guy, Paul. He's my guy. I love Paul. He did some cool stuff. Paul was this guy who went around killing Christians, throwing them in prison. He is persecuting the church, is the phrase that they use about Paul. Paul's on this road one day. He meets Jesus. Jesus changes his life. He starts to walk with Jesus, and he's a found person. Found people find people. So Paul just starts planting churches. Wherever he goes, he meets people. He finds a core group. They start a small group. They plant a church. He equips leaders. He goes to the next place. That was Paul's model and his method. And then he became pen pals with these churches. So he would write them letters saying, how's it going? What do you have questions about? What are you learning? What's taking you down? And then they'd write letters back and forth. We have those letters in the New Testament. It's such a cool thing. We've got these ancient letters. And Paul fell in love with a city called Corinth. He was there for about 18 months, so a year and a half, falls in love with the people, starts a small group, puts some leaders in place, goes off, and he's riding back and forth with them, and he finds out that they've got a destination mindset. They're thinking in terms of pass, fail, win, lose, black, white. And he writes to them and says, that's not actually God's model for any of us. Notice what he says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. He says, anyone who belongs to Christ, and that word belongs with Christ means that you're walking in partnership with him. It's not just praying a prayer and getting some fire insurance for when you die. It's actual partnership. It might start with a prayer of acknowledging, I want to walk with you, Jesus. And then it happens as we partner with him and we become God's child. God's Spirit fills us, and God begins to work in our lives as we walk with him, changing our desires, changing our hopes and our dreams. He says, anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old life is gone. A new life has started, has begun, is beginning. And I like the way Paul finishes that. He's very intentional with the word picture. He doesn't say the old life is gone, now you've graduated. That's destination thinking. He doesn't say the old life is gone, now you've reached enlightenment. He doesn't say the old life is gone, now you figured it out or finished the race. He says the old life is gone and this new life has begun. And he uses it intentionally because we know that when a new life begins, when a child is born, they know nothing. And they have a process of learning everything. And those of us who are followers of Jesus, he says, we're in the same process. Now, we have a ton of grace for kids in this process, don't we? Like when your kid's learning how to walk and they fall down, you're not like, get up, stupid. I volunteer in my son's kindergarten class every Friday. I love it. I learned so much about life being with kindergartners. And recently, I had the chance to read with some kindergartners. And they're doing blending right now, where you take like the TH, that sound, you know? So they're doing blending and learning. And this girl, Kate, comes up. She's the sweetest little girl. And she gets her reading. And she gets to the first word. The first word is the. And she's like, you know what I didn't do? I didn't say it's the, stupid. The. It's a sight word. It's on your sight word tree. You've been looking at it all year. It's the. Because your pastor is quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to become angry, deeply gracious. No, who would do that? The answer should be, Mary, let me be clear, no one would do that. It's the stupid. No. Here's what we did. Okay, Kate, let's look at this. It could be, but let's try this. I think this is a blend. Let's try that. And she was like, the. Yes, that's it. Awesome. Great job. Let's go to word two. Only 50 more in this book. This is what it's like when a new life begins, isn't it? We're learning new things. Now, we get it with kids, but when we become adults, we don't give ourselves the same, and here's the word, and this is going to be the word that's going to walk us through this whole thing. We don't give ourselves the same grace that we give to children. And grace is simply this, it's undeserved favor. It's what God gives to us, undeserved favor. It's what God invites us to give to ourselves in this process of becoming. We don't expect our kids to know everything at age 5, and yet when we get in this destination thinking, we assume I know the right thing, I should be doing the right thing, and when I'm not, I'm failing, and that's just not, it's not true. So what I want to do for our last few minutes together is talk about what it looks like to replace some old thinking with some new thinking. Because if we're going to actually be on a journey with God, we have to die to some old self-thinking and be born again or raised up to new ways of thinking and dreaming and imagining life. So I want to talk about three lies and then three truths that go with it. The lies are old thinking. The truth is new thinking. The first lie is this. Things are never going to change. Man, that is the thing that sinks couples in a series like this. We've been in it 5 years, 10 years, 15 years. We've got this pattern set. It's never going to change. I've got this anger thing that I cannot get rid of. It's never going to change. I've got this addiction that I keep trying to break. It's never going to change. Our finances have been in this cycle for years. It's never going to change. I'm stuck in this job that I can't get out of, but I don't love, or I can't get in this job that I really want. It's never going to change. And eventually, if we have that mindset, we will give up. We just will. Because if it's never going to change, then why keep trying? But God says it can change. It might not change overnight. If you're 10 years into a pattern that you now recognize as unhelpful, what if you gave yourself the grace to say, we're going to take 10 years to learn a new pattern? None of us does that, do we? We think, I've spent 10 years on this old pattern. I'm going to give it 5 weeks, 5 weeks. That's long enough. You can change anything in 5 weeks. And then 5 weeks in, we realize, oh, it's still fairly the same. A little better, but fairly the same. Well, I guess we should just scrap it. If it's never going to change, then there's no point in trying. But God says it can change. That same guy, Paul, was in prison with very little hope of getting out. And he said this thing that became, if you grew up in Southern California in the 90s, it became the Bible verse that every jock put on their Letterman's jacket. And I'd ask him, do you know what that means? And they'd be like, no. And I said, yeah, me either. So let's look it up. It was Philippians 4:13. It was like the football player's anthem if you were a Christian. Philippians 4:13, taken totally out of context for football, is not helpful. In context, is very helpful. Paul, in prison, doesn't know if he's going to get out. He says this, I can do all of this. This life, this calling, this hardship, this pain, through Christ who gives me strength. What if we switched our thinking when it came to that area that feels like it's never going to change and said, wait a minute, I can actually do this in partnership with God. Change is possible. It might be slow going, but it is possible. I don't know about you, but when things get tight for me, when I get to my margins and I feel like I don't have any space, I tend to focus only on what needs to be done, what's not working, what's not going well. Anybody else? Oh, all the time I find myself doing that. Right now, I'm in a pretty busy season in terms of ministry and life and figuring things out. And I find myself driving. I was going to meet a buddy for coffee on Wednesday morning. I found myself driving there just thinking about all the stuff that I didn't do, that I needed to do, that wasn't done yet. And then God brought this idea to my mind. God just slowed me down and said, what's good in your life right now? I had to think about that for a second. what's good in my life? Well, at that point, Landon had had 2 days of my six-year-old, 2 days of a very kind heart. Like, he was being kind, complimentary. Listen, a year ago, that I would have been like, that's a miracle. That's good in my life right now. I looked at my wife. She started this new job, this full-time job that's definitely stretching her, but she's like blossoming under it. Well, that's really good right now. I'm driving in this super fun. I've got a 73 MGB convertible, and it's not pouring down rain. Praise God, that's good right now. And I'm going to meet a buddy of mine just to talk about life. That's pretty good. Who gets to do that on Wednesday morning? This guy. That's pretty good. And I got to coffee with him, and he was a little stressed out too. And so I asked him the same question, what's good in your life right now? He sat and thought for a while, and he listed off 2 or 3 good things. And we talked to each other later that day, and we both said that really changed our perspective for the entire day. And I love the way that Paul says it. This is in Philippians as well. Remember, he says, I can do all things. He says it because of this mindset. In Philippians chapter 4:8, it's not in your notes. I'm sorry. I just thought about it on Friday when I was working on this message last minute. Philippians 4:8, you might want to write it down. It says, brothers and sisters, whatever is true and noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, whatever is excellent and praiseworthy. Here's what he says. Think about those things. Because when we get in a mindset that says it's never going to change, all we can see is what's not happening. I bet if you looked at your spouse with this mindset, you could find at least one good thing about them. Can I challenge you to do that today? Just one good thing. They are wearing shiny shoes. That is a good thing. Whatever it is, you know. Maria could look at me and be like, his hair is never messed up. That is a good thing. Like, take the small wins. It could change your mindset for what it's worth. Okay, lie two. We got to keep going. Lie two. It's all my fault. This is destination thinking. Destination thinking has us thinking it's all someone's fault. It's either all mine or all yours. And here's how it usually goes in our mind, and you can start on either side. I tend to start with the it's all your fault. So you might not. You might start with the it's all my fault and then swing there second. I almost always am sure that because we're in a fight, it's probably your fault. That is just my default. I'm working on it. But here's how it starts. You get into a fight. You think, it's all your fault. This is happening. In our first year of marriage, this happened a ton, this pattern. We'd get into a disagreement, a spirited disagreement, and I would leave the house, get in the car, drive away, just to take a drive. I needed to get out of the house. And as I'm driving, I'm thinking about all the reasons why it was her fault. She did this, she did that, she said this. How dare she tell me how to, you know, load the dishwasher and cut that onion? What's she thinking? I'm a grown man. And then I get, that's a true fight. Not both of those on two separate occasions. And then I get 15 minutes into my drive and realize, wait a minute, she's just trying to be helpful. You're being so insecure and arrogant. And then it's like, oh, it's all my fault. And none of us likes to live there. You know what that is? That is condemnation and shame. When we think it's all our fault. Because listen, there's two people in any fight, and it's definitely part your fault. It always is. But it's also part their fault. So it's all my fault. But none of us is designed to live here. That's why Jesus says, let me take away your condemnation. Let me take away your shame. Let me replace that with my Holy Spirit and hope and forgiveness. But if we're sitting under that common condemnation, the next thing we do is we just push it back to them. No, it really was all their fault. But then we realize, nope, she was just trying to help with the dishes. It's all my fault. And we swing back and forth, back and forth. Because remember, it's win, loss, black, white, pass, fail. What if there's a different way to do it? I love this. I was talking to our executive pastor. This was probably a year and a half ago. She was in here when I shared this, so we'll see if I get in trouble later. I was talking to our executive pastor, and I had to go into a meeting with her. Something had happened. I was pretty sure it was one of our faults. You can guess whose fault I assumed it was. So I was kind of spooling up. I was getting ready for a little bit of a spirited conversation because I was pretty sure somebody was to blame. And I walked in and I said, this is what happened and we need to fix this and what, you know, how could this have whatever? And she said, okay, I hear what you're saying. She said this. She said, what if it doesn't matter whose fault it is? I said, it does, because we all know whose fault it is. She's like, what if it doesn't matter whose fault it is? What if we stay on the same team, partner together, and try to fix the problem and never, and get this, never decided whose fault it was? Would that be okay? Well, I had to sit there for a second. I'm like, that makes sense. But the truth is, it's your fault. But let's try it. I said, let's try it. So we did. We partnered together. In the process, I realized it was at least 3% my fault. At least. So I'll take some ownership of that. But in the process, I realized ultimately in most fights, it doesn't matter whose fault it is. The answer is not to figure out who gets the 51% of the blame in a fight. The answer is to do this thing that Paul talks about, which is experience the favor of God in our lives and then give it away. Notice what he says here. Truth number two, and it comes again from 2 Corinthians, this time chapter 9. Paul's talking about this thing that he has that he's praying that God takes away from him, but he says, but God said to me, my grace is sufficient. And that word sufficient means unfailing, will never fail, will never let you down. My grace is sufficient for you. My power, Jesus said, is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, Paul says, I will boast all the more gladly in my weakness. I can own my faults because in my weakness, Christ's power rests on me. Verse 10, this is why for Christ's sake, he says, I delight in weakness. I delight in hardships. I delight in insults. I delight in persecution. I delight in difficulties. The things where we feel like we need to protect ourselves and build up and build walls and blame the other person. He says, no. I experience the grace of God in my life, and it is sufficient. It's actually perfected when I acknowledge that I'm not perfect. Because if I'm already perfect, God doesn't need to perfect anything in my life. Paul says the answer is simply this. It's the grace of God that saves us. When you came into a saving relationship with God, it wasn't you. It was the grace of God to you, that undeserved favor to you that saved you. But most of us are taught that it's God's grace that saves us, and it's our job for the rest of our lives to convince God that that was a good investment. You saved me, now I need to figure it out myself. And that's not ultimately true. Paul says that same grace that saved you is available to you every day. So you get in a fight with your spouse. You get in a fight with your kids. You get in a fight with a coworker. And instead of trying to determine who's got the majority blame in this so I can stand on my rights, instead we simply say, wait a minute, God's grace in this moment, God's grace is sufficient for me to cover over my part of this mistake. And I'm good enough in Christ in this moment. And now I can actually give you the same grace that I'm experiencing. Because listen, it can change. And it's never all your fault. That's the voice of condemnation that says it's all my fault. But I can tell you a little secret. It's never all their fault either. So we both need grace. And the third is this. We believe a lie sometimes that I'm the only one who's ever experienced this. I'm going to say something to you, and you can write it down in your notes if you want to. You are unique. Your situation is not. You are unique. Your thumbprint is unique. You're like a beautiful snowflake. Listen, you're unique. Your situation is not. Here's why that's so important. Oftentimes when things get tough at home, things get tough at work, things get tough with family, things get tough with finances, we assume I'm the only one who's ever experienced this. And we're told that the enemy of our souls, the devil, he's like a lion who roams around at night trying to get us away from everybody else so he can devour us. The devil honestly wants to make you think that no one could ever come through a marriage like you. No one could understand your marriage. No one has been through it. Listen, you are unique. Your marriage is not. Other people have sat where you sit today, and they've come out on the other side stronger, and they've come out on the other side more fulfilled, and they've made it. Or let me say this. Other people have sat where you sit today, and they've come out on the other side heartbroken. And if you come out heartbroken, you need them in that moment too. Because you're not alone. The enemy tries to get us alone. He tries to get us to think, I'm the only one who's ever experienced this kind of shame or regret. when I'm raising my kids. I'm the only one. How's this? If you're single in here today, the devil would want you to think, I'm the only one who hears a sermon like this or a series on marriage and feels alone in this room. You're not the only one. The downside of a marriage series is it hits a specific demographic. You're not alone in this. In fact, I hope you didn't feel that way in this series. But the devil tries to get us alone when what we actually need is we actually need to hear stories about how we're not alone. We need to hear the stories of other people who have walked through it. This is why I say to young couples all the time, in your first year of marriage, get into a life group. I don't care what they're studying. I don't care what they're talking about. I don't care if the Bible study is good. You need to get into a life group so that it can normalize marriage for you. Because you're going to think, we're the only ones who got in a fight about me wanting to put the dishes on this side of the sink and him wanting to put the dishes on this side of the sink. You're not alone. Been there, done that. It normalizes it. You're the only one who's ever felt like, we're married. We had our honeymoon. We got on a fight in our honeymoon. We should get divorced right now. You're not the only one who's thought that. Other people have thought that. Yeah, I guess you should all be in a life group with me, basically, is what I'm saying. You're not alone. The answer is community. Notice the truth, truth number three. It comes from Acts chapter 2. It's the first early gathering of Christians. And I want to highlight one thing. We're not going to get too big into this, but I want to highlight this. Notice all the community language. How many times, you can underline it or circle it as I read. Notice how many times a we is inserted. It says, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship. That means that they were in relationship together. To breaking of bread, that means they ate together. Everyone was filled with awe, and many wonders and signs were performed by the apostles. 44 says, all the believers were together. They had everything in common. They sold their property and possessions and gave to anyone in need. Every day, they met together in the temple courts. They broke bread together in their homes. They ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and having the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number those who were being saved. I count at least 15 different they, them, together, relationship, eating together, worshiping together, talking together. Do you know why that's so important? It normalizes life. And the minute you get alone, the enemy wants to tell you that this situation is unique to you and no one could ever understand and you're never going to get out and you're going to be trapped. And Jesus' remedy for that is community life. So find it. It could be in a life group. It could be on a ministry team. It could be in your section where you sit. Find it. Find it somewhere. As we wrap up this series, if I could dream for our church for a minute, I would dream of a place where we know that we're in process together. Every single one of us. Myself, you, them, even them over there. We're all in process together where we would say it's okay to not be okay. Let's just be honest about it. We're walking with Jesus on a journey, and it's a lifelong journey that will not be perfected until we enter into eternity with God. Until then, we're going to be journeying with him. And I'd want you to walk into church, feel empowered and encouraged and given some tools. My hope would be you'd walk out of a marriage series saying, I'm so glad we heard that, because it gives us some tools for the journey, rather than saying, I can't believe how far we have to go. Can we ever make it? Because the truth is, you can. You can. And God's going to take you there. In 2 weeks is Easter. Can you believe that? 2 weeks, I'm starting a conversation that's going to take us through the summer. We're going to start with Jesus' best friend, arguably his best friend, the guy who Jesus set aside, said, this guy's going to lead the church. And on Easter, at Jesus' biggest moment of need, when he needed his friends around him the most, this guy abandoned him. This guy rejected him. This guy denied him. If anybody had a reason to feel like I could never come out of that, it's this guy. And on Easter, we're going to look at the fact that Jesus actually restored this guy and the way he did it, and then the journey he took him on to lead the church. And we're going to talk about it because if he can do that for him, he can do it for you and your friends and your kids and your parents. And then we're going to start about a 10-week series that's going to be kind of a wandering, meandering into discipleship, what it means to partner with God practically and experience maturity and growth in our life. Because spiritual maturity is not take these 5 classes and then you're mature. Spiritual maturity is journeying with God. And I'm going to give you some tips and some tools on how to journey with God to experience maturity in your life. But as we pray right now, I want to give you a chance. If you've never started this relationship with him, started this journey with God. You can start this journey right now, right now. This prayer does not mark anything. It's no magic formula. It's simply you acknowledging, I want to walk with God in this life. I'm going to give you a chance to do that. So would you join me as we pray? Well, for all of us, Lord, would you show us what it looks like to take up that invitation that you gave to those first disciples, to simply follow you, to walk with you, to partner with you, as you help us to become the women and men who you saw from the creation of this world. Would you show us what it looks like to walk in relationship and give you the space to do the transforming? And if you're here today and you're ready to start this journey with God, to stop walking on your own and start walking with your Heavenly Father, you can repeat this simple prayer after me. It's simply a way to acknowledge this thing that you're feeling inside as you take this journey with him. You can say these words. Say, Lord Jesus, I believe that you love me, that you're calling me into your family, and that you're calling me to follow you. And I want to do it. So would you come into my life? Would you forgive me of my sin? Would you fill me with your Holy Spirit? And God, would you show me what it looks like to have a journey mindset as I walk with you? I pray in your name. Amen.